Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. Welcome to yet another interesting video lecture on engineering mathematics. Hopefully you're all doing great and continuously revising the concepts that I covered in the last 8 lectures. If you have not gone through them, I suggest you to go through them first and then hop on to this particular video. Okay? So, continuous revision of the lectures that I have covered so far is a must, is the key to success. If you don't revise them properly, you will not be able to procure success at the end. Okay, so proper scheduling of your studies and proper and sticking to the timetable that you have prepared for yourself is the key. Okay, don't be flamboyant, don't be adamant, don't be arrogant in your while studying in your studies. Okay, and don't even dare to compete with others like that. You have to be perfect. That's what you have to think about. So if you really like the video, please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section. In the last lecture, I basically ended my discussion with the introduction to limits, continuity and differentiability. So I'm going to kickstart this video with some examples which would basically make the concepts more clearer to you. Okay? Hopefully you are also solving the numerical problems. Okay, let me start off with this. What should be the value of lambda such that the function is continuous at x is equal to pi by 2? It is equal to this function at when x is not equal to pi by 2 and x is equal to 1 if x is equal to pi by 2. So we know for the continuity to exist at a particular point, we know that the left hand limit must be equal to right hand limit must be equal to the value of that function at that particular point. Okay, so if we apply the limit, at x is equal to when x tend to pi by 2, if we apply this lambda cos x divided by pi by 2 minus x. Now you can see this basically it's an indeterminate form. We cannot directly put the value of pi by 2 in this equation and solve. Okay, either we can replace x with the pi by 2. We can replace x with the pi by 2 plus h. Or what you can do, we can apply the L'Hopital rule. Okay, let's apply the L'Hopital rule. So differentiating the denominator and the numerator, we get lambda, this you get minus lambda sine x divided by, this is minus 1. Okay, now if we apply pi by 2, we get sine pi by 2 as 1. So we get lambda, we get it as lambda sine pi by 2. This should be equal to f of x is equal to pi by 2, which is equal to 1. In this case, we get from here lambda as 1. So lambda is equal to 1. So C option is the correct option. Let's have a look at the next question. The function this. Now we have this function, which is f of x, which is mod of 2 minus 3x. Okay. We have to determine whether this function is continuous or differentiable or neither of them. So that can easily be done with the help of drawing the diagram of this thing, or you can solve the limits. What is the basically the point of inflection? If we just see, this will basically be equal to 2 minus 3x when x is less than 2 by 3, and this will be equal to 3x minus 2 when x is greater than or equal to 2 by 3. This is what we have. So if we just have a look at the plot of this function, we can say the point of inflection is 2 by 3 and the function looks something like this. This is a straight line with a slope of minus 3 and the slope is plus 3 here. So this value is 2. So this is f of x with respect to x. Now from here we can easily see that the function is continuous at x is equal to 2 by 3 because there exists a continuity. So continuous at x is equal to 2 by 3. But the function is not differentiable at x is equal to 2 by 3, it is impossible to determine the slope at x is equal to 2 by 3, but not differentiable at x is equal to 2 by 3. Else it is differentiable at any other point except 2 by 3. So the option C satisfies our explanation. The option C is correct. Let's have a look at the next question. The function f of x is x is equal to x sin x satisfies the following equation, which is this: f double prime of x plus f of x plus t cos x is equal to 0. Then the value of t is what? So it's quite simple question. So we have x f of x is equal to x sin x. Okay. So if we just have a look, that f prime of x will be equal to x cos x by applying the chain rule plus sin x. Okay. So f double prime of x it will be equal to minus x sin x plus cos x plus cos x. So we have f double prime of x plus f of x plus t cos x is equal to 0, and this will be equal to minus x sin x plus cos x plus x sin x plus t cos x is equal to 0. We get 2 plus t times of cos x is equal to 0. We get t plus 2 is equal to 0. T is equal to minus 2. So t is equal to minus 2 is the correct answer. Let's have a look at the next question. The question: let f of x is equal to x to the power minus 1 by 3, which is the 1 by cube root of x, and a denote the area of the region bounded by f of x and the x axis when x varies from minus 1 to plus 1. Which of the following statement is are true? F is continuous in minus 1 to 1. Let's basically go statement by statement. Let's try to prove this statement. So let us check the continuity at x is equal to 0. Okay, let us check the continuity at x is equal to 0. So left hand limit must be equal to right hand limit. This must be true. Let's have a look at the left hand limit, which is basically limit x tend to 0 minus f of x, which is nothing but your limit x tend to 0 minus 1 by cube root of x. Now let us replace your x with 0 minus plus h. Okay, so from here we get limit h tend to 0, you get 1 upon cube root of x will be replaced with 0, since we are using, since we are finding out the left hand limit, so we will conclude the 0 minus h. This is not 0 minus, so x is replaced with 0 minus h, so this will be 0 minus h. So when h tends to 0, this will be equal to 1 by minus 1 by 0, which is minus infinity. Okay, let's find out the right hand limit, which is equal to limit x tend to 0 plus f of x, which is nothing but limit x tend to 0 plus 1 by cube root of x. Now in this case we replace x with 0 plus h, so this will be equal to limit h tend to 0 1 by cube root of 0 plus h. This will come out to be plus infinity. Now since left hand limit is not equal to right hand limit, so not continuous. So the statement 1 is totally false. Let's have a look at the second statement. F is not bounded in minus 1 comma plus 1. So the second statement is absolutely correct. Yes, it is not bounded. Yes, the function f of x is equal to x to the power minus 1 by 3 is not bounded in minus 1 comma plus 1 at x is as the function f of x takes the value minus infinity at 0 minus and plus infinity at 0 plus. That's why it is not taking a finite value, so it's not bounded at x is equal to 0. So statement 2 is absolutely correct. Okay, third one is a is non-zero and finite. Since a is non-zero and finite, so let's just have a look at the third statement. So we know that area is nothing but equal to mod of integration from minus 1 to 0 x to the power minus 1 by 3 d of x plus integration from 0 to 1 x to the power minus 1 by 3 d of x. This will give you the area. This is nothing but 3 by 2 x to the power 2 by 3 minus 1 to 0 plus 3 by 2 x to the power 2 by 3 from 0 to 1. This will give you the area. This is 3 by 2 plus 3 by 2. This will be equal to 3. Yes, the area A is bounded. A is non-zero and finite. So, statement 3 is absolutely correct. So, 2 and 3 statements are correct. So, the option C is the correct option. Let's have a look at the next question. Let's have a look at this theoretical question. Given the following statements about the function f r to r, select the right option. If f of x is continuous at x is equal to x naught, then it is differentiable at x is equal to x naught. If the function f of x is continuous at x equal to x naught, then it may. So we it is not certain that if the function is continuous at x equal to x naught, then it is differentiable at x equal to x naught. With this statement is not always true. It's not true always. For example, if we just have a look at this modulus function, which is mod of f of x. So this function is continuous at x is equal to 0, but not differentiable at x is equal to 0. Okay, continuous but not differentiable. Statement P is totally false. If f of x is continuous at x is equal to x naught, then it may or may not be differentiable at x equal to x naught, which is absolutely correct statement. Okay, if f of x is differentiable at x is equal to x naught, then it is also continuous at x is equal to x naught. Yes, it is true. If the function is differentiable, then it has to be continuous. So this statement is also true. So option B satisfies our explanation. So option B is the correct option. Okay, now we are going to start off with some important theorems based on continuity and differentiability and limits that you must remember, because you can expect a lot of questions from these three theorems. Okay, so these theorems are also called as mean value theorems. Let's just put the heading mean value theorems. Okay, the first theorem that I'm going to discuss is the Rolle's theorem. Okay, Rolle's theorem. Rolle's theorem says, if a function, let's say f of x, is such that the statements are very, very important. First, f of x is continuous in a closed interval, a and b. Let's say there a and b are the two extreme points. So this basically continuous in the closed interval a and b. Second, f of x exists, or f of x is differentiable. Yeah, f prime of x exists for every point in the open interval a and b. Okay, because the function cannot be differentiable at the two extreme points, it's quite tacit. Third, then, and f of a is equal to f of b. This statement needs to be true. Then there exists a value c, where c belongs to a and b, such that f prime of c is equal to 0. Okay, so for example, if we just have a look at this particular plot, let's say this is basically f of x and this is x. Let's say this is the function. Okay, this is the plot. Let's say this is x is equal to a, and let's say this is basically x is equal to b. You can see the function is continuous at x is equal to a and differentiable in the open interval a and b. Let's say these are the two values, let's say f of a and f of b. So there exists a point c in the open interval a and b, such that f prime of c, which is the slope of a slope, which is f prime of c, is equal to 0. the slope of the function at x is equal to c is equal to 0. The slope is equal to 0. Okay, it's important to note down that its Rolle's theorem will not hold good for if the function is discontinuous at certain point in a and b, and f of x is not differentiable in the open interval a and b, and f of a is not equal to f of b. Okay, will not, if the function is discontinuous, not differentiable, and f of a is not equal to f of b, then Rolle's theorem cannot be applied. Okay. Second theorem that we are going to discuss is Lagrange's mean value theorem. Second one is basically Lagrange mean value theorem. Okay. Lagrange's mean value theorem. So for a function, let's say f of x, certain points need to be true, then we can conclude some one result. First, if a function f of x is first continuous in the closed interval a and b, which is the closed interval. Okay, second one, differentiable in the open interval AB. Okay, and there exists a value C in the open interval A and B such that f prime of c is equal to f of b minus f of a upon b minus a. This is how it goes. Okay, so let's have a look at the plot. Let me show it with an example. Let's say this is f of x and this is x. So if the function plot is somewhat like this. So this is basically a, this is b, and this is c. So f dash of c, which is f prime of c, this is the slope. F prime of c is nothing but equal to f of b minus f of a upon b minus a. Okay, this is how it goes. And this fails. This Lagrange's mean value theorem fails for the function if it is discontinuous in the closed interval a and b and not differentiable in the open interval a and b. Okay, the third theorem that we are going to discuss is the Cauchy's mean value theorem. Okay, third theorem is basically Cauchy's mean value theorem. Okay, this is an important theorem. So let's say if f of x or g of x are two functions defined in an interval a and b such that g of x and f of x are continuous in the closed interval a and b. Okay, second, g prime of x and f prime of x exist in the open interval a and b. Third, g prime of x is not equal to 0 for all x belonging to a and b. Then we can say, there exists one C in the open interval A and B such that F prime of C divided by G prime of C is equal to F of B minus F of A upon G of B minus G of A. Okay? And if g of x is basically equal to x, then Cauchy's mean value theorem, Cauchy's mean value theorem turns into Lagrange's mean value theorem. So Lagrange's mean value theorem is a special case of a Cauchy's mean value theorem. Let's have a look at some questions based on this. So we have this question. Let's have a look at this question. Verify the Rolle's theorem for the following functions and find the point or points where the derivative vanishes. So we have this particular question. So as we know, the sinusoidal and cos functions are both sinusoidal functions, so they are always continuous. Okay, so from here we can infer that f of x is continuous in the closed interval 0, π/2. It will be continuous at every point in the interval 0, π/2. And since it is basically a smooth curve, so f of x is differentiable in the open interval 0, π/2. Okay, now there exists f of 0 is basically sine 0 plus cos 0, and this is basically equal to 0 plus 1, which is equal to 1. And we know that f of π/2 will be equal to sine π/2 plus cos π/2. This is equal to 1 plus 0, which is equal to 1, which is equal to f of π/2. So this thing is also verified, that f of a is basically equal to f of b. It's also verified that f of a is equal to f of b. Then there exists a point C. In the interval, open interval 0, π/2, such that f prime of C is equal to 0. Now we know that f prime of x will be equal to cos x minus sine x. We just differentiate that thing with this. So then f prime of C will be equal to 0, which will equal to cos C minus sine C is equal, okay? So which is equal to 0. So from here, we can say that tan C is equal to 0, okay? So we can say that tan C is basically equal to 1, okay? Tan C is equal to 1. So then C will be equal to π/4 or 5π/4 or 9π/4 or -3π/4, etc., etc. But C basically lies between 0, π/2. So hence we can say that C is equal to π/4. So C is the point of point where the differentiation vanishes. The derivative vanishes. So there exists f equal to π/4 such that f prime of π/4 is equal to 0. So C is equal to π/4, hence Rolle's theorem is verified. Let's have a look at the next question. So verify the Lagrange's mean value theorem for the following functions in the given interval and find C of this theorem. So the other two questions given to you separately. Let's solve for the first question. x squared plus 2x plus 3 in the interval 4 and 6. Now since it's basically a polynomial function, so since f of x is a polynomial function, so continuous in the interval 4 and 6. Since it is polynomial as well, so since f of x is polynomial function, so differentiable in the open interval a and b. So it's important to note down that a polynomial function is always continuous and differentiable in a particular interval given. So since both the conditions satisfied, so there exists, so we can say there exists some value c in the open interval 4 and 6 such that f prime of c is equal to f of b minus f of a upon b minus a. Okay, so from here we can say that f of 6, which is f of b, will be equal to 6 square plus 2 into 6 plus 3. This will be equal to 27. And f of 4 will be equal to 4 square plus 2 into 4 plus 3, which is equal to 16 plus 8 plus 3, which is 27. So if you solve for this, this will be 51 and this is 27. Now such that we know that f prime of c is equal to f of b minus f of a upon b minus a. We know that f dash of x will be equal to 2x plus 2. Okay, so f prime of c will be equal to 2c plus 2. So 2c plus 2 will be equal to f of b, which is 51 minus 27 divided by 6 minus 4. Okay, 6 minus 4. We get 2c is equal to 10 and c is equal to 5. So c is the value which is 5. So there exists, so we can say there exists c in the interval 4 and 6 such that f prime of c, f prime of 5 is equal to f of 6 minus f of 4 upon 6 minus 4. Okay, now let's have a look at the next question, the second one. The question is basically for, we are given the function f of x x px square plus q x plus r, where p is not equal to 0. So from here, since it's a polynomial, f of x is continuous in closed interval a and b, and f of x is differentiable in open interval a and b. Since both the things are satisfied, so there exists c in the interval a and b such that f prime of c is basically equal to f of b minus f of a upon b minus a. So we know this f prime of x is equal to 2px plus q. So f prime of c is equal to 2pc plus q. Okay. Now f of b is equal to pb square plus qb plus r, and f of a is pa square plus qa plus r. Okay, so from here we can say that 2pc plus q is equal to pb square plus qb plus r minus pa square plus qa plus r divided by b minus a. If you solve for this, you will get c is equal to a plus b by 2. C is equal to a plus b by 2. And this basically exists in the interval a and b. So there exists c is equal to a plus b by 2 in the interval a and b such that f of a plus b by 2 is equal to f of b minus f of a upon b minus a. Okay, hence the Lagrange's mean value theorem is verified. So according to the rail engine accelerates from its stationary position for 8 seconds and travels a distance of 280 meters. According to the mean value theorem, the speedometer at a certain time during the acceleration must read exactly what value. So let's say since the position of the rail engine, let's say is s of t. So for the mean value theorem to exist, this has to be continuous and differentiable. So st is continuous, we can say it's continuous and differentiable. Continuous and differentiable function. So according to Lagrange's mean value theorem, where let's say for all t where t is lying between 8 and 0 seconds. So because we are asked to find out in between 0 to for 8 seconds, 0 to 8 seconds. Okay, this is the interval. Okay, so we can say that s of t will be equal to v of t, let's say velocity v, vt, such that s of 8 minus s of 0 divided by 8 minus 0. Because we know that s prime of t, so this is s prime of t, differentiation, so we know this thing that velocity is nothing but dx by dt. So we can say s prime of t will be equal to v of t is s of 8 minus s of 0 upon 8 minus 0 meters per second. So s of 8, position at 8 second is 280 meters, and at 0 it is 0, so this is 8 minus 0, okay, which is nothing but 280 divided by 8 meters per second, which is the velocity. So the 280 by 80 is meters per second. We can just multiply or divide by 18 by 5. So 280 divided by 8 into 18 divided by 5 kilometer per hour. This will be equal to 126 kilometer per hour. This is your velocity. Okay, this is the constant velocity. So the option D is the correct option. Okay, okay. So you must be now. I'm going to discuss about the differentiation, and you must be familiar with the basic differentiation of some functions. Let me just tabulate them, and I am hoping that you know the chain rule and etc. How to solve the logarithmic differentiation, etc. So now I'm not going to discuss that in this particular lecture. I'm just writing some functions and its derivatives and its corresponding derivatives. So differentiation of some functions, some important functions that you should know. Okay, so let me discuss that one by one. So we have x to the power of n, the differentiation of this thing will be equal to n x to the power of n minus 1. It's quite simple. We have then ln x, its differentiation is 1 by x. We have then log x to the base e, some base a, sorry, this will be equal to 1 by x log e to the base a. Okay, then we have e to the power x, it will remain e to the power x. A to the power x is equal to a to the power x log a to the base e. Okay, sin x differentiation is cos x, cos x differentiation is minus sin x. Okay, tan x is 6 square x. Then we have sec x is sec x tan x. Then we have cosec x, we have minus cosec x cot x. We have then for cot x as minus cosec square x. Sine hyperbolic x is cos hyperbolic x. Cos hyperbolic x is sine hyperbolic x. Okay, sine inverse of x is 1 by square root of 1 minus x square. Then we have cos inverse of x has 1 minus 1 upon square root of 1 minus x square. Then we have tan inverse of x as 1 upon 1 plus x square. Cosec inverse of x has minus 1 upon x square root of x square minus 1. Sec inverse of x has 1 upon x square root of x square minus 1. Cot inverse of x has 1 upon 1 plus x square, and mod x has x upon mod x, where x is not equal to 0. Okay, now first I am going to discuss about the Taylor and the Maclaurin series, and then we shall hop on to the maxima, minima in single derivative and partial derivatives, and increasing and decreasing functions, and study about maximas and minimas as well. So first I'm going to discuss you about the very important topic of this chapter, Taylor series and Maclaurin series. Let me just start off with this. This is very important topic. You should know the Taylor series and Maclaurin series, how to use them, how can we write the Taylor series expansion of a particular function. Okay, so Taylor and Maclaurin series. Okay, so first we are going to discuss about the Taylor series. So it's very, very important for you to pay attention to it, okay, because this is a very important topic. Let's say if f of x, let's say this is some function f of x, and its first n minus 1 and its first n minus 1 derivatives be continuous in the interval a and a plus h, and f n of x, matlab nth derivative of x, exists for every value of x in the interval a comma a plus h, open interval a comma a plus h, then there is at least one number theta, let's say one number theta, which lies in the interval 1 and 0, such that f of a plus h is equal to f of a plus h f prime of a plus h square by 2 factorial f double prime of a plus up to h to the power n upon n factorial f nth derivative of x at x is equal to a. Okay, so just make a correction here. That's basically not the case. Let me just write it below, because I am left with no space here. So this will be equal to h cube by 3 factorial f triple prime of a plus dot 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 plus h to the power n upon n factorial f nth derivative of a plus theta h. This is the Taylor series expansion of f of a plus h. Okay, this is a Taylor series expansion. Okay, so this is called as Taylor theorem with Lagrange's form. Of remainder Rn being h to the power n upon n factorial f nth derivative of a plus theta h. Okay, so this is basically the remainder, and rest is the Taylor's theorem, which is Lagrange's form of remainder Rn being h to the power n upon n factorial f nth derivative of a plus theta h. Okay, now there are two corollaries. So let's say corollary 1, let's say taking n is equal to 1, let's say n is equal to 1, for if we just put n is equal to 1 in this series, if n is equal to 1, then Taylor's theorem reduces to reduces to Lagrange's mean value theorem. Okay, if we just put n is equal to 1 here, let's say n is equal to 1, so we get up to here, so we get f dash of a as f of a plus h minus f of a divided by h, so which is we get f dash of a is equal to f of a plus h minus f of a divided by h. This is nothing but your Lagrange's mean value theorem. Okay, the second corollary, which is corollary 2, which says put a is equal to 0 and h is equal to x, then we get f of x is f of 0 plus x f prime of 0 plus x square by 2 factorial f double prime of 0 plus up to x to the power n upon n factorial f nth derivative of 0. This is known as the Maclaurin series. This is Maclaurin. Maclaurin's theorem with Lagrange's derivative. Lagrange's form of remainder. So just a minute change in the Taylor series gives you the Maclaurin series. Okay, what do you have to do to get the Maclaurin series? So you have basically f of a plus h, you just have to substitute a as 0 and h as x, a as 0 and h as x, so then we get the Maclaurin series expansion. Okay, so these two series that I have written are basically the theorems, because the remainder exists in both the series. Okay, you cannot call this as a Maclaurin series. It's basically a Maclaurin theorem. It transforms into a Maclaurin series when the remainder tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Okay, so if we just talk of the Maclaurin series, if we just talk of the Maclaurin series, let me just write the definition so that it is more clearer to you to understand. Okay, let's say if f of x can be expanded as an infinite series, then f of x is equal to f of 0 plus x f prime of 0 plus x square by 2 factorial f double prime of 0 plus x cube by 3 factorial f triple prime of 0 up to infinity. So if f of x possesses derivatives of all orders and the remainder Rn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, then the Maclaurin series becomes the Maclaurin series. Okay, similarly in case of your Taylor theorem, if remainder tends to infinity, the Taylor's theorem becomes Taylor's series. Okay, so if remainder tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, then theorem becomes series. Okay, this is an important line. The one that I have written here is basically a Maclaurin theorem. theorem. And this is also a Taylor theorem. If the remainder, which is basically your Rn, tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, then it becomes Taylor's series. Okay? Now let's solve some questions based on these two theorems. Okay? But before starting off with some questions, let me write down the series expansion of some well-known functions. So let me start off with the expansions by use of known series. Okay, let's just write them down first. For example, the first, let's say we have sine theta. The series expansion is theta minus theta cube divided by 3 factorial plus theta to the power 5 divided by 5 factorial minus theta to the power 7 by 7 factorial and so on and so forth. Okay. Second one is cos theta. This is 1 minus theta square by 2 factorial plus theta to the power 4 divided by 4 factorial minus theta to the power 6 divided by 6 factorial and so on and so forth. Third, let's say we have tan theta, which is theta plus theta cube divided by 2 plus theta to the power to by 15 theta to the power 5. That's basically 2 here. Okay. And so on and so forth. The fourth function is, let's say, if e to the power x, which is 1 plus x square by 2 factorial plus x cube by 3 factorial plus x to the power 4 by 4 factorial and so on and so forth. The fifth function is, let's say, log of 1 minus x, that's the base e, is equal to minus of x plus x square by 2 plus x cube by 3 plus x to the power 4 by 4 plus and so on and so forth. By the way, that's basically these are all the Maclaurin series. These are not the Taylor series expansion of the given functions. These are all the Maclaurin series expansion of the given functions. Okay. Six sine hyperbolic theta will be equal to theta plus theta cube divided by 3 factorial plus theta to the power 5 divided by 5 factorial plus theta to the power 7 divided by 7 factorial and so on and so forth. The seventh function is cos hyperbolic x, let's say 1 plus x square by 2 factorial plus x to the power 4 divided by 4 factorial plus x to the power 6 divided by 6 factorial and so on and so forth. The eighth function, tan inverse of x is x minus x cube divided by 3 plus x to the power 5 divided by 5 minus and so on and so forth. The ninth function is log of 1 plus x is x minus x square by 2 plus x cube divided by 3 plus x to the power 4 divided by 4. Okay. And so on and so forth. The tenth series is 1 plus x to the power of n is equal to 1 plus nx plus n into n minus 1 divided by 2 factorial x square plus n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 divided by 3 factorial x cube and so on and so forth. 11th one is 1 minus x to the power of minus 1 is 1 plus x plus x square plus x cube and so on and so forth. 12th one is 1 minus x to the power of minus 2 is 1 plus 2x plus 3x square plus 4x cube and so on and so forth. The 13th series is 1 plus x to the power of minus 1 is 1 minus x plus x square minus x cube plus x to the power 4 and so on and so forth. The 14th series is 1 plus x to the power of minus 2, as 1 minus 2x plus 3x square minus 4x cube, and so on and so forth. So these are some the Maclaurin series expansions of some basic functions. Based on this, we shall discuss the question, we shall solve some examples in the next lecture. Till then, revise all the concepts that I covered in the last 9 lectures. If you have any doubts, write them down in the comment section below and keep yourself in touch with the DigiMentor. Thank you very much.